So I would be talking about, so we have this saying that when life gives you lemon, make lemonade, make money. So when life gives you orange, we'll talk about what orange is. So when life gives you orange, make data speak volumes. To give a short summary about myself, I'm a computer engineer at heart. I'm a tech geek. I started my speaker journey 2 years back at a PyLadies event with my very first Python workshop. I'm an ACM scholar, a Google scholar, and a GHCS scholar. I also run a nonprofit organization which works in India across 10 cities across the country. And that's my Twitter handle. You can tweet, you can DM after the session as well if you have any doubts or anything that you'd like to collaborate on. I'm open to it. Let's look at an overview of what data mining is. So when we have a lot of data, we need to find patterns so that the data can make more sense to us. So it is like an autonomous process to discover previously unknown patterns which are valid, potentially useful, novel, and understandable from large data bases. With the increase in technology, storage is no longer an issue. Storage has become very cheap. So the amount of data that can be stored has increased to a huge number. So data mining can be has grown because of that in the current age. This gives you an overflow of what happens in data mining. In data retrieval, we collect valid information, which is related to the domain that we are working on. Then we have data pre-processing. In data pre-processing, you do not want any missing values in your data. You want to implement algorithms so that the missing values are replaced by means or by a logic so that it fits into your data. And you also want to remove any noise that is there in the data. Then comes data analysis, wherein you add various algorithms, the actual logic of what do you want to do with your data. You, all of that logic, the algorithm, the coding part comes in here. And finally, we have the interpretation. That is giving the business users or the high level authority of the company an idea of what we can do with the data that we have. There are four types of data analytics. So here you can see compiled it into like short statements as to what each of them does. So if we're talking about descriptive type of data analytics, then it is what is happening in my business. So if, for example, I run a bakery, I need to know what do my users like. Are they buying bread or are they buying buns? So what is actually happening in my business? If it is of the diagnostic type, so why is it happening? Why is it that some of the customers who I get are buying buns more on specific dates? More on the holidays. Why is that so? If it is predictive, so predictive is very important when you want to increase your sales or you want to increase your revenue or you want to scale up your business as well to various locations or increase it in size in general. So what is likely to happen is interpreted through this type of data analytics. The last one is the prescriptive type. That if I have a goal set, so how do I reach to that goal? That path is paved through the prescriptive type of data analytics. Many people get confused between what business intelligence is and what data science is. So this graph will clearly give you an idea both with respect to the approach that we have and the time frame in which we are working. So business analytics is mainly dealing with the past data. So whatever is the data collected, you represent it in a visual form for everybody to understand. Like the yearly or quarterly reports that a company makes, all of that comes in business intelligence and see what the trajectory of a company has been. And data science is more about data mining and predictive analysis. That we want to reach a goal, so how do we reach that goal? That is very important, especially in the current world when everything is global and you want to scale up even in multiple countries. So how do you do that? That comes in data science. The main reason why the talk is important and why data visualization is a very important need in today's world is because of the large amount of data that we have. Large and huge amount of data is called big data. And big data can be structured, unstructured, semi-structured, quasi-structured. That is, like, it can It can be text type of data, which is easiest to handle, or you can have image and audio and video, or you can also have a clickbait type of data, that is the clickstream data. So in today's world, when ads play a very important role for companies like, for the monetary models of companies like YouTube or any other social networking platform to earn revenue. So all of that also becomes a part of big data. And the three major challenges are of volume, velocity, and variety. Because of these challenges, handling big data poses a problem to the data scientists. Volume deals with the scale of data that you have, huge chunks of data that are there. Velocity is how frequently and how fast the data is being generated. And variety is the different forms of data. As developers and software engineers, we need to find the right balance. We need our products to be technology-centric as well as human-centric. That is, they need to be engineering-oriented so that whatever is the logic or the algorithm, it needs to be correctly implemented. It should be of the correct mathematical model. But it should not be that only people from our domain, people who have computer science knowledge should understand it. Everybody or our target business user should be able to understand it. So that is where design orientation comes into place. So we all know that pictures are more easy to understand as compared to text data. Even if a person does not have a domain knowledge of a particular subject, but if there's a very simple graphical or a pictorial form of that information given to the person will be able to understand what is being tried to convey or what is the other person trying to tell me or give information to me about. So that is why we need to find the right balance for it to be technology-centric as well as human-centric, so that both of them go hand in hand. Data visualization. So data visualization is the pictorial representation of data that is a end result of data mining and data analysis. We should be able to easily represent it to the audience that is our target audience. The objectives of data visualization are to get the data in context. If you have 1 lakh records, it is very difficult to navigate and understand what each record is trying to convey information. If you have pie charts or bar graphs, you'll be able to compile those 1 lakh records into a single picture and display to the user. It should be an understandable form of data. You cannot just write numbers. Those numbers should make sense to the reader. We should be able to find patterns or relationships between the numbers that are being there, the various records that are there. And we should be able to also make comparisons. It should not be that we are pictorially representing data, but a year later, same the fields remain the same, the data, the main record changes, but we are not able to link the 2 years of visualizations. We should be able to compare it. This is the big data ecosystem. So we have the 4 big drivers of big data. Data devices, that are the data generators. The second is the data collectors. So right from our government, medical, that is hospitals, of finance, phone, TV, our shopping websites like Amazon. So all of them are data collectors from our devices. The third are the data aggregators. So many a times these are various individuals, sometimes marketers, SEO optimizers, who are the data aggregators. And the last are the data users or buyers. So many media firms buy data from each other. For example, back in India, we have the Grab service here, we have Ola there. So Ola bought in data of Food Panda in India. So they directly bought it, and all users who were registered to Ola directly, they directly sold the data to Food Panda. So there are many data users and buyers. This is the whole big data ecosystem, which is why we have huge data that is being generated. There are 2 major abilities. The computer ability. Computers have the ability to do complex calculations. They are able to store data. And we as humans, we are more creative. We have intelligence because of which we can understand data, which the computer needs to be programmed to understand it. We can also learn domain knowledge directly by reading through the manuals or reading online about it. So we need to make the best of both of these abilities, the computer ability as well as the human ability, to design the system or model that we plan to propose. So the system or model would engage in logic, analysis, and prediction. But if we just rely on computers to do it, then we would go back to the 90s, wherein we did not have such a great scale. But now that we need to use both of these abilities, we will be able to scale and move forward very, very fast. Now let's talk about what Orange is. So Orange is an open source machine learning and data visualization tool. This can also be used in directly in Python. You can import Orange. You need to clone the repository, and then you can install, and you can import it directly in your Python scripts as well. We would look at the tool and see why is it so trending, where all it is being used. The three key features about Orange, the tool, is that it helps uncover hidden data patterns. It provides intuition. So you get an intuition of what is about to happen or what this data is trying to tell me. And also the communication between the data scientists and domain experts becomes very, very easy. Also an important note, to use Orange, you do not need to know data mining or data analytics in particular. But you can actually use it in your self project or in your company and go ahead with it. Some major features and description of what Orange is. So Orange is a component-based data mining tool. So as you can see, like there are various components. These are called widgets in Orange. Like we have the file, the data table. Then we have a widget called logistic regression, which directly implements logistic regression. You do not need to write the mathematical equation, or you do not need to know what how to actually program it. It does it for you. And then you can have the confusion matrix, the true positives, the true negative, everything populated, directly calculated, and you can use this output in your plots. It has a very interactive data exploration. So Orange, the widgets communicate with each other. They receive data on input and send out filtered processed data to the models or the plots that are there. As you can see, so there's a file out of which we have connected one link directly to the plot, and one is through the data table. So in the data table, you will be able to see the file. This file will have an input of a large data set that you can include, and to view it in a tabular form is the data table widget. And you can see that you can have various plots, and directly you'll have colors as well, which makes it easier for everybody to understand. Even here, if you see, so in the decision tree that has been made below, so you can select a part of it, and you can select a specific color for a particular branch of the tree, and the same gets reflected in your plots as well. You do not have to do additional coding, or you do not have to specifically specify it somewhere. Once they are connected with each other, once they are in the workflow, it happens from one input to the output, and it goes on. Orange is very beginner friendly. Even if you have an idea in your mind and you want to see how efficient would this be, what sense can I make of the data that I have, or I would like to go into Twitter analytics, but I want to understand about it, I want to see what the data is trying to say, and then maybe figure out what I wish to do. So Orange is very beginner friendly in that manner. So, and also it is very smart. So as you can see here, so if you have the distances widget, this can be the Euclidean distance, the Manhattan distance, various distances through the modulus or the mean square root. So as soon as you click and pull the connection link, you'll see a smart drop-down list wherein you can type or search among them. So you do not have to worry about compatibility about one widget to the other. Directly in this flow, you will get to see what widgets are there, which are comparable, compatible, and which are not. And there are a number of plots and visualizations that are there, from scatter plot, box plot, to Pythagorean forest, heat maps, anything and everything that you wish to have in your data is all there in orange. Now, many of you must be wondering that we have a lot of data with a lot of features. Many times when we developers are trying to create a model, we tend to get confused of what features to select, which features will give me the best output, which features will actually help give correct class labels to my various clusters of data. So here is where Orange comes to the rescue. Orange has intelligent visualization. Intelligent visualization is that you can have score plots. You can have all possible comparisons made. For example, if there are 1 to 10 features, so it will create a comparison between 1 and 2, 1 and 3, all of them, and till 9 and 10, and it will give you a score, this Silhout score. And you can see that how well, which two features will give you the desired output, which two features will give you more discrete class labels for your data. It also has reporting. So whenever, so this helps in maintaining, what changes you have done over time. That is also taken care in Orange. It might be possible that right now it is working correctly and maybe you did something because of which now it's completely broken. But you want to go back to the last working possible stage. So you can see it through reporting and see that this was the stage that it was working correctly. I can go there. So it will help in version control. I'll show you a short demo of how does Orange look like. So this is the Orange canvas. Over here, you'll see various widgets that are there. So let's build a very simple Orange workflow. You have to just drag and drop it. Once you drag and drop it, you have the file. File will be my input file. You need to double click on it. And here, through the drop-down or through the folder list, there are many data sets which come with Orange. So these, you can choose any one of them. Well, for example, if we are choosing housing, and directly, and then just close this window. After this, I would like to apply k-means clustering, the unsupervised learning clustering method, which is very famous. So I would pull out a link from this. It can be anywhere. If I pull out a straight link, the intelligent dropdown directly comes. Here, I can type in k-means and just enter. It would load in fast. And here you can double click on it and see there are two types of, so we need to decide the value of k for how many clusters do we need. K determines the number of clusters in k-means. So if, for example, we want to keep it fixed to 2, if we have done some background work and have done some mathematical calculation and determined the number of clusters, so we can keep it here and close this. And we can create a new link. We can choose MDS. It will give a more pictorially clear view of what is happening. So here, you double click on it. And you can see that there are two clusters. We had selected the K value to be 2. So these are two discrete clusters that have been formed, C1 and C2. Also, there's a control for jitter. So you can increase or decrease the jitter directly in the sliding bar. So it is very, very user-friendly, very beginner-friendly. You can play in with the various widgets. You can have the number of iterations. The default is set to 300. You can increase it, decrease it, depending on the data and the domain you're working in. You can have randomized as well. Now, coming back to k-means here. So for example, if we are not sure that what is the optimal number of clusters for the data that we are working with, so we can go to from. And so we can have minimum 2 to maximum 8 number of clusters. This is what I plan to handle. So give me the optimal the optimal value of k. Here, these are the various Silhout scores. So how does this scoring work? Is that if there are 2 clusters And if consider like one cluster is here, one cluster is here. If you have a data point that is here, the scoring will be very high because it is more close to this cluster. If it is as you go in far away from it, so the score decreases because it is not that compactly close to the cluster. And if there are two clusters and if you have a data point which is directly in between them, the Silhouette score is zero because it can belong to any one of the clusters. So this is a very easy understanding of how the scoring works. Then there are various distances that you can have, but this is like a general overview of how the scoring works. Even if the the ones at the back cannot see the numbers written, but you can see the line, the blue line that is there, which is proportional to the score that is given. So here, 3, that is k is equal to 3, has the maximum score of 0.723. So we select this, we close this, and we check out the plot. So here you can see that C1, C2, C3 in red, blue, and green are the three clusters that have been formed. So directly this. Also, you can try and see. So for example, 8 is the, it is the worst, it has the worst score. So let's see how would that plot look like. So can you see it is so compact? That is why it is not the optimal value of k in between the score range that we have given. Also, if you want to, when you start using Orange and if you want to see how do I play around with data, I do not have, I do not directly want to work on data, I want to actually see how it's working. So you can choose the paint data object widget, you can double click, and so I'm clicking with my mouse on the blank screen, and that is a cluster that I'm forming. And so for example, I've painted this data, and then I want to apply k-means. And from that, I want to see the plot. So these are the two clusters. So they are very much in sync of what I had drawn, what I had painted my data on. So this way, you can explore various widgets of Orange and get more insight on it, because the more hands-on, it's very easy to use. The interface is very, very easy to use. So once you play around with it for, even if you play around with it for half an hour, you'll get a feel of what we are trying to do. I would like to discuss a very interesting use case that Orange is being used in. So the Hayabusa 2 asteroid based sample mission is being done by the Japan Space Agency. So Orange is being used there. So Orange is already in space. So why don't we on Earth use it when it's right made in on the Earth? So the images are copyright, so I could not show in the images in the slide. But so in the mission, we on Earth are receiving images of the asteroid samples. And then, so this is like, this is a short workflow of the asteroid that is being done. So in the very start, you can see that you see the asteroid name, and then we are having the data table, we have the reshape map, we have various widgets which are analyzing the image. So an important thing, yes, Orange is not just limited to text, you can do it on videos, images as well. So especially when you do it with images, so you do not have to know how to process images, or you know, images are a bit complex to handle as compared to text. So you do not have to worry of that. Orange takes care for you. And it's taking care of it even right in space. So yes, it is very efficient. These are the references and attributions. This is also the website, orange.biolab.si, wherein you can directly download you can directly download either for your Python script, there's the GitHub link there, or you can download it as a software and use it on your machine for your self projects, or you know, any project that you wish to use it for. Also, before concluding, I would like to show that you might be wondering that if you have this plot, so how do you save it? If you just want to, because people don't believe without proof, you need to print it and give it as a proof to your manager that yes, this is like the right number of this is the right value for k in the k means, or this is not the right value. So right here for easy, you can see that there's a save image option. The floppy disk icon, that is the save image icon. You can directly click and you can choose where do you want to save it. And you can save it as a PNG file, SVG, or even a PDF, and you can save it there. So yes, that's it from my side. Thank you. Thank you for listening.
All right, thank you. Any questions or is it over here? Is there a question? Yeah.
Let me just come over the mic.
There you go. Do you know of a tool that we can export Python code after we do the visual aspect? Let's say I am done with the global.
Yeah.
From
Python?
From Orange, can I export it to a Python file?
Yeah, you actually can embed Orange in your Python script itself. Yeah. And then directly use so there's a syntax like Orange dot and you'll have save image or save file. So you can save it there. You cannot do it the other way around. Yeah, you cannot do it the other way around, but you can use Orange in your Python script and then do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah.
I got another one in case no one is.
Are there any further questions for the rest of the audience? You get one more question. There you go.
Yeah, so Orange is really interesting because of visual aspect.
Yeah.
Do you find any limitation in the data that you can load in it?
The data that I've worked with, I did not face any limitation. The regular limitations of, for example, k-means, that is there. So I tried this wherein I tried to draw a smiley face using the paint data function. And so what I wanted to do was to have one eye as one cluster, the other eye as one cluster, and the smile as one cluster. But it did not do that. So that is... So there's no... the data that I worked with did not have any issue with it.
Final call for questions. Otherwise, thank you very much, Drishti.
Thank you.